a lot of apps, honestly.
And it's just gotten completely out of hand. Look at that.
That is. Hey, what are you guys talking about over there?
Bijan is showing me his phone apps.
My reliance on technology.
Thrilling.
We were going through my apps. No, we were talking about, well, let me ask you guys. When was the last time you had to get from A to B and you could do it without using an app?
Without?
Yeah.
Yes.
I think I've literally never done that. I mean, just this is really embarrassing, but just an example. I was looking for a pharmacy this morning, and before even using my brain or using my eyes, I Googled it, and turns out it was 80 meters away from where I was. And bearing in mind, I walk past this pharmacy twice a day as well, to and from work. Like,
and
it shows
also,
you how mindless I am.
Matthias, you have those big green signs.
Yeah, they're a giveaway too.
Yeah, but see, I'm so delulu about this because I'm like, yeah, I don't need the map app. I'm fine. And among all of us, we all know I have the worst sense of direction.
You're quite
bad.
Yeah,
you're really bad. You're
And I'm just convinced. I'm like, I can do it without it.
The reason we were talking about it is because this London cat piece I was working on,
oh, yeah.
Obviously it's all about using, like, memorizing your path and your route and using your brain,
yeah.
And how that can actually help prevent Alzheimer's. So we can watch the piece. I think there'll be a lot to talk about after we see this package. Classic American in London. Some of the things I find really fascinating about this city are the double-decker buses, iconic, and the London black cab drivers. And there's something actually really unique about a black cab driver. It's their ability to memorize every single road in London, more than 25,000 of them. So my plan today is to jump in the back with one of the drivers, test their knowledge, and figure out how their brains might actually be wired differently than, say, mine. I just gotta get a cab. Taxi? He was on his phone. Hey, how's it going?
Good afternoon, sir.
UCL?
No problem at all.
You can get me there?
Absolutely.
All right. All right, so we are in the back of a black cab. Our driver today is Tom. Tom, I'm gonna quiz you as we go. Is that okay?
Before getting behind the wheel, London cabbies have to pass the knowledge. It's a verbal exam, proving that they know every street, landmark, and hidden shortcut in the city. No GPS, no maps, just their brain.
Now I'm gonna pull up my phone.
Okay.
I don't want you to cheat me.
Perishable.
Well, how would you get from here to 26 Bedford Way?
Right, we'll leave on the left Old Street, we'd go forward Clerkenwell Road, right into Grazing Road, left into Northington Street, right into John Street, forward Doughty Street, left Guildford Street.
I gotta stop you there. I'm not saying you're wrong.
It's impossible.
You said turn right on Gray Street, right?
Grazing Road.
Grazing Road, yep.
Left Northington Street.
See, I have left on Guildford.
You may well have, but if you want to go the long route, that's absolutely fine by me. I've just cut out a traffic light. I'm also showing the Dickens Museum at number 40, but if you want to go the long road, we can go via the M25, sir.
All right. I trust you.
Trust me, knowledge is power.
How long did you spend memorizing these streets?
I did the knowledge pretty quickly. So I'd done it in 13 months. On average, it takes between about 3 years.
Tom passed the knowledge back in 1991, but in a city like London, the challenge never really stops.
So right now we're going to UCL. What is going through your mind right now?
Every time I go on any journey, I'm thinking about roadworks, diversions, are there any demonstrations going, and which is going to be the most efficient.
What's really fascinating to me is obviously Tom's incredibly knowledgeable when it comes to London, but his brain could also hold the key to unlocking something about Alzheimer's. So we're here at University College London, where we're gonna meet Dr. Hugo Spiers, who's leading research that Tom's involved in, scanning the brains of cab drivers like Tom and his colleagues.
So this is the Birkbeck University College London neuroimaging unit. This is where Tom would have been scanned, yep, inside here. So just come in, and be very careful in here because it can be, as you see, there's warning signs up everywhere.
Don't touch anything.
Don't touch anything, it's science, so everything don't touch.
Professor Spiers' research focuses on the hippocampus, an area of the brain that supports memory, navigation, and broader cognition.
So what's happening right now is Matt has volunteered to be scanned. So he's prepping for the MRI right now. And Professor Spiers will scan him, we'll pull up his scan, and then we will compare that to a London cab driver.
Thanks, Matt.
Here we go.
He looks very calm and relaxed. So, okay, so this is Matt's scan we have up here.
Yeah, exactly.
And then this is...
a London taxi driver.
Just an anonymous London taxi driver.
Exactly. By eye, I can see there's a slight difference in the hippocampus, very slight. But of course, we do science, we measure lots and lots of taxi drivers' brains and lots of non-taxi drivers' brains, match for age and gender and all these other factors you want to control. And at the end of it, we find that this bit here is just slightly larger.
So how does all this relate to Alzheimer's?
Well, very sadly, in Alzheimer's disease, the hippocampus and the area next to it, the entorhinal cortex, are some of the earliest brain areas affected by the disease. And these bits of the brain are critical for memory and for navigation. And so when the disease progresses, this bit of the brain gets smaller and smaller and shrinks away. And that's what's fascinating here is that whilst Alzheimer's patients are getting smaller in the hippocampi as time passes, London taxi drivers are actually increasing the size of their hippocampus if they're a licensed taxi driver. So this is not all taxi drivers, it's specific to ones who use the knowledge.
Last question for you.
Yeah.
Do you believe that anyone that has the work ethic and willpower, can they study for and pass the knowledge?
Absolutely. Nobody fails the knowledge, they give in. So if you've got the commitment, you've got the determination, the will to do so, you will become a London cab driver.
What you're saying is there's hope for me.
I can train anyone. Yeah, I mean, you might be a challenge, but you know, once I start to understand your accent, I'm sure we'll get there.
Perfect, what do I owe you?
5120.
Tom, what a legend.
He was a legend. It was nice spending the day with him. Me and Ben behind the camera got to spend the day with Tom. We didn't talk about this in the piece, but Tom's mother unfortunately passed away from Alzheimer's last year, which is unfortunate, but it was really nice to see how he's involved in this research and how his brain and the brain of his colleagues are helping kind of unlock some of these secrets to Alzheimer's.
Yeah. I mean, if I took away one thing from that package, it's... I'm worried about the size of my hippocampus.
Yeah, Tom has a very large hippocampus.
It's a really interesting point because there is this hypothesis out there called about digital dementia, which suggests that because we're becoming increasingly reliant on tech, that our brains might be forgetting skills like memory loss, things like that. But actually, information released earlier this year suggested that that's not the case at all. And if I refer to my notes very quickly so I get this right.
Just my little notebook.
Literally. This article suggested that actually tech use in people who are getting older improved their cognitive impairment, associated with lower cognitive impairment by 42%. So actually had benefits.
Yeah. Using technology.
Yeah.
I think it's augmenting technology.
But on that point, I'd love to see if there's sort of like a generational shift between our parents and us, because on road trips, when I was younger, one of my core memories is my parents getting out that huge road atlas.
Big map.
With every single road in the UK, and you have to find the right page, use the coordinates to find the right road.
Yeah.
And ever since I've been driving, there's either been sat nav or apps, and it's just a skill and a part of my brain I have just never needed to use.
Go ahead.
So I do get in fights with my dad when we're in the car together because he just cannot understand how I can't read the signs, I can't read the arrows on the road because I'm just so used to talking to me.
It is laziness. I asked Tom, I'm like, how do you feel about people like me and my generation that use sat navs? He goes, just pure laziness, really. And,
it's lazy.
He's right, though.
Yeah.
He's right.
Yeah. Relying on them, too much.
And decades later, if I speak to my mum, she still knows all of these roads in the area that she worked in years and years ago.
Yeah, it's interesting too, because they did this study with bus drivers, London bus drivers, and they found that their hippocampus wasn't growing like a cab driver.
Oh.
And it's because that these cab drivers have to memorize these streets and learn this knowledge, whereas a bus driver is doing the same route every day. So they're not using their brain like we would.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it was interesting that Tom was, bearing in mind all the traffic lights and avoiding things like that. I had no idea that that's what the knowledge was about.
Yeah. Very, very smart guy.